Welcome, everyone. Welcome to our worship service as we continue on our journey of love during the season of Epiphany, the season of revelation, discovery, and calling. Today, we gather virtually as one family in the name of Jesus. We profess our faith in an open and affirming community who take our directions from the radical love of Jesus as motivation and inspiration for everything we do. Please know that whoever you are and wherever you are on your journey of faith, we are pleased that you are worshiping with us. Today we will join our hearts and minds together, ready to learn about Jesus, who continues to be our light in the world. During these difficult times, we ask that you continue your generous commitment to the organizations that desperately need help at this time. The Elizabeth Fry Society, Center 507, the Ottawa Mission, and local food banks are just a few that are dedicated to helping the most vulnerable people in our society. You can find information about these communities on our website. If you would like to donate to the church, you can do so online by e-transfer to muchurch@bellnet.ca. Or you can send a check to either Merivale or Fallowfield Church. You can find each address on our website, www.merivalefallowfield.org. These are all the announcements at this time, and so we hope that you will enjoy the worship service that is all about our commitment to making the world a better and kinder place. We light a light in the name of the God who creates life, in the name of the Savior who loves life, in the name of the Spirit who is the fire of life.
O God of all creation, who has come to us in Jesus, lead us in your way of love and fill us with your Holy Spirit during our worship service. Let us pray. O God, who called all life into being, the earth, sea, and sky are yours. Your presence is all around us. Every atom is full of your energy. Your Spirit enlivens all who walk the earth, and with you we yearn for justice to be done. We yearn for your kingdom of peace to come on earth. We believe in you, O God, whose love is the source of all life and the desire of our lives, whose love was given a human face in Jesus of Nazareth, and whose love is our glorious promise of freedom. Therefore, though we are sometimes fearful and full of doubt, in you we trust, And in the name of Jesus, we commit ourselves in the service of others to seek justice and to live in peace, to care for the earth and to share the commonwealth of your goodness, to live in the freedom of forgiveness and the power of the Spirit of love and in the company of the faithful, so to be the church for your glory. And now, O God, we pray that you hear us as we say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I just want to give a little note that our opening prayer came from the Iona Abbey Worship Book.
Good morning, everybody. I'm reading selected verses from Psalm 104, God, the Creator and Provider. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty, wrapped in light as with a garment. You stretch out the heavens like a tent. You set the beams of your chambers on the waters. You make the clouds your chariot. You ride on the wings of the wind. You make the winds your messenger, fire and flame your ministers. You set the earth on its foundations so that it shall never be shaken. You cover it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. They rose up to the mountains, ran down to the valleys to the place you had appointed for them. You make springs gush forth in the valleys. They flow between the hills, giving drink to every wild animal. On the streams, the birds of the air have their habitation. They sing among the branches. From your lofty abode, you water the mountains. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of your work. You cause the grass to grow for the cattle and plants for people to use, to bring forth food from the earth and wine to gladden the human heart, oil to make the face shine and bread to strengthen the human heart. The trees of the Lord are watered abundantly, the cedars of Lebanon that God planted In them, the birds build their nests. The stork has its home in the fir trees. The high mountains are for the wild goats. The rocks are a refuge for the conies. You have made the moon to mark the seasons. The sun knows its time for setting. You make darkness, and it is night when all the animals of the forest come creeping out. O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Yonder is the sea, great and wide. Creeping things innumerable are there, living things both small and great. These all look to you to give them their food in due season. When you give to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to God, for I rejoice in the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Good morning, friends of Merivale and Fallowfield. This morning, I'm reading Psalm 19, God's glory in creation and the law. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words. Their voice is not heard. Yet their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In the heavens, God has set a tent for the sun. It's rising from the end of the heavens and its circuit to the end of them, and nothing is hid from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes. The eye of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings from the honeycomb. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts always be aligned with your love, O God. Amen. Many of you already know that I am a big fan of Celtic spirituality. And what I love about it is that it is an earthy religion based on a close and intimate relationship with the environment. It was established as a distinctive expression of the Christian faith passed down to us from the peoples in the far west of Europe. Celtic spirituality is holistic, life-affirming, and faithful. And Celtic Christians who adopted this way of life lived close to nature and close to God. The three most instrumental people who built up the Celtic Christian Church were St. Patrick, who brought Christianity to Ireland, Columba, who took Celtic Christianity from Ireland to Scotland, and Columbanus, who founded various religious communities in Ireland. These men helped to distinguish the characteristics of Christian Celtic spirituality from Roman Christianity, which focused more on dogma and doctrine. I believe the early Celtic Church has much to teach us today. First and foremost was their strong belief in the goodness of community. It wasn't simply a matter of just declaring truths about the teachings of Jesus, but about actually living out the gospel in community. The well-being of each member of the community was important, and everything was shared. All people were taken care of. They also had a deep love and respect for others and a high regard for children, especially orphans. And there was equality between the sexes. No hierarchy of reverence. All were venerated equally. The early Christian Celts were known for their hospitality toward the stranger, because for them, when you welcome the stranger, you were welcoming Christ himself. So they are described as good to the poor, kind to the stranger, and courteous to all. Now, there was also a strong belief in the sacredness of the universe, and especially of the earth. And this strong sacramental outlook saw God in everything, and it encouraged a reverence for God's creation and a respect for the care of God's world. Celtic Christians saw themselves as the caretakers of this sacred gift of life and creation. I think this feature of Celtic spirituality, its creation emphasis, its deep sense of awe at creation, is probably what we can learn the most from. Celtic Christianity can teach us that nature is also God's holy word. It encourages listening to what nature can teach us, and it also encourages experiencing at the deepest levels possible a type of communion with God and nature. The early Celtic Christians saw the world as the temple of God, where people experienced a deep soul connection with the mystery that sustains creation. This abiding love of all creation was a hallmark of the Celtic faith. The Celtic Church differs from our Western Church in that it teaches that we are to look for God within creation and to recognize the world as the place of revelation and the whole of life as sacramental. Not just our church sanctuaries or Sunday worship, but all of life. And we hear this in Celtic prayers and poems that speak of the earth and the universe as graces, and the spiritual coming through the physical, and God being seen as the life within all life, and not just as a creator who set life in motion from afar. St. Columba and St. Patrick continually portrayed the elements of the earth as expressions of God's grace and goodness, and they encouraged people to see God in the ordinary and everyday routine of life. Emphasis was put on seeing the image of God at the heart of all people and in everything around us. British theologian Pelagius, who lived in the 4th century, stress not only the essential goodness of creation and our capacity to glimpse what he called the shafts of divine light that penetrate the thin veil dividing heaven and earth, but very specifically the essential goodness of humanity. Pelagius saw God as present within all that has life, and he understood Jesus' command to love our neighbor as ourselves to mean loving not only our human neighbor, but all the forms that surround us, all life forms. According to Pelagius, when our love is directed towards an animal or even anything in nature, we are participating in the fullness of God's love. The Celts, true to the teachings of Jesus, also had a passion for justice. Celtic Christianity was marked by its political character, seeking justice and charity, and Celts were social activists through the media of pastoral care and spiritual development. For the early Christian Celts, goodness is all that is creative and promotes caring for creation and all humanity. They were committed to love of God, love of neighbor, and love of self, and this meant that they lived under a Trinitarian banner, loving God with heart, soul, and mind. They saw God as uniting all things within God's self. You know, we can learn much from early Celtic spirituality, which was holistic and integrated, that saw life as one and was lived under the guidance and protection of God, on whom the people were very dependent. For them, there was a unity of all things in God, humans, the animal kingdom, and the physical environment. It was reflective and based in a strong sense of solidarity within the community, the environment, and the community of God as Trinity. It was a life that taught that all of creation is interdependent, to be seen as sacred, and to be respected and treated with dignity. This faith tradition has a lot to teach us, and I think that is why it is so popular with New Age spirituality today. And this faith tradition calls us to listen for God, not only in the ordained teaching and life of the church, but in all of nature. May God open our hearts to all of creation around us. Amen.
To a Song Thrush, a poem by 18th century Welsh poet Thomas Jones. Frail bird of taut loveliness, you enrich and you astound us. We wonder long at your song, your artistry and your voice. In you I see, I believe, a splendid and unique work of God. God is glorious and glorified, showing his virtue in the smallest creature. How many bright wonders, clear note of loveliness, does this world contain? How many parts, how many mirrors of God's splendid work offer themselves 100 times to our gaze? For the book of God's art is a speaking light of lines abundantly full, and every day, one chapter after another comes among us to teach us of God. The smallest part of the work of God's most lovely hand becomes our teacher, lordly and true. A winged and lively bird who gives an impromptu sermon, who teaches us much of our Lord, who is master, of his power and his wealth, and of his wisdom great and true. If our Lord is great, and great is God's praise from just this one small part of earth, then what of the image of God's greatness which springs from God's work in its fullness? Through the image of the ascending steps of that gracious work which God has made, below and above the firmament, the number of God's marvels is without number. What of the greatness which is that pure loveliness of our God himself? Thank you.
Please join me for our closing prayer, which comes from St. Patrick's breastplate. Today we shield ourselves with threefold power, invocation of the Trinity, belief in the threeness, profession of the oneness, in union with the Creator. Today we shield ourselves with the power of Christ's baptism, his crucifixion, burial, his rising again, and his ascension. Today we shield ourselves with the loving power of the cherubim, obedience of angels, service of archangels, prayers of the patriarchs, sayings of the prophets, teachings of the apostles, and deeds of righteous people. Today we shield ourselves with the power of heaven, light of the sun, brilliance of the moon, splendor of fire, speed of lightning, swiftness of wind, depth of sea, firmness of earth, and hardness of rock. Today we shield ourselves with your power to direct us, your strength to uphold us, O God, your good sense to guide us, your ear to listen for us, your speaking to speak for us, your hand to guard us, your path opening before us, your shield to protect us. We summon these powers to come between us and everything that threatens our body and soul. And so we say, Christ be with us. Christ be before us. Christ be behind us. Christ be inside us. Christ be beneath us. Christ be above us, Christ on our right hand, Christ on our left hand, Christ when we lie down, Christ when we sit down, Christ when we rise up, Christ all around us, Christ in the heart of everyone who beholds us, Christ in every eye that sees us, and Christ in every ear that hears us. Today we shield ourselves with threefold power, invocation of the Trinity, belief in the threeness, profession of the oneness, in union with the Creator. May your salvation, O Lord, be always with us. Amen. May God write a message upon your heart, bless and direct you, then send you out living letters of the word. Amen.